presenting our case today. So this was a 63-year-old gentleman presented in February 2016 with some difficulty in motor work. His best corrected visual acuity was 6/12/8. He presented with bilateral full thickness macular hole, stage 4, both having some cystic cavities associated with it. He underwent cataract surgery along with vitrectomy, island peeling, and gas tamponade with CK effect at a gap of 6 months. So right eye in February 2016 and left eye in August 2016. OCT scans were taken at 6 weeks post-op. Right eye showed a closed macular hole with some defects at the ISOS junction. And left eye showed some incomplete closure with again defects at the ISOS junction. Again, the visual acuity was 6/9 and 6/24 in respect to right and left eyes. Again, an OCT scan was taken at 8 months post-operatively. Right eye, at this point of time, there were some inner retinal dimples which were seen in both the eyes, with the visual acuity being 6/9 and 6/18. Left eye had an incomplete closure with some bridging glial tissue. Then he presented after 1 year. These inner retinal dimples were seen more properly at this visit, but the visual acuity wasn't getting hampered. The visual acuity was 6/6 in the right eye, 6/12 in the left eye. Then he presented after 5 years in this September. There you could see some arcuates, triae, or some defects, concentric defects near the fovea, and along with some RPE defects in both the eyes, which were there previously also. On NFAS imaging, these were seen more well, as this moth-eaten appearance was seen. A line scan through that showed the same retinal dimples, which were seen more better this time. But the visual acuity is good. It is 6/6, 6/9 on both eyes. This appearance was first time described in 2001, and which is called as dissociated optic nerve fiber layer by Tadayoni et al. They found this appearance in 43% of the eyes after ERM removal. No functional effect was seen, no effect in visual acuity. There was no difference in visual recovery also. Since then, there have been many studies to find out why this appearance has been seen in eyes after ILM peeling. So they tried to correlate it with a lot of other factors. They gave a hypothesis saying that it either might be because of traction exerted on the retina during the removal of the ILM and the ERM, or it might be due to permanent damage to the Müller cells. Or one more thing is that the ILM, the two surfaces of ILM, the inner surface is the smooth one, the outer surface is the rough one. So after removal of that, the exposed rough surface formed by the RNFL fibers might be the reason for this. After 3 to 4 years now, they started doing studies where they started seeing whether it is limited to ERM removal or ILM. And they came up with a hypothesis that this is because of ILM peeling, because they compared the patients who had not, and there were no such cases seen in patients who had not undergone ILM peeling. And this was mainly cleavage of the optic nerve fiber bundles due to damage of the Müller cells. That is what was being said at that time. Then the next thing they tried to correlate was whether there was any correlation with the ILM staining technique, which was not found. The use of ICG to stain the ILM did not affect the incidence, and no functional abnormality was detected using, and they tried using SLO microperimetry and visual field testing also. There was no difference in these patients compared to the other ones. Spade et al. In 2012 suggested that the term dissociation was not the proper term, rather it should be inner retinal dimpling, because it was cleavage of the optic nerve fibers and not dissociation of the fibers, and it appeared around 1 to 3 months post-op and became distinct after 6 months. There were studies which tried to correlate different surgical techniques used for the ILM peeling with this appearance. Some found a correlation and some did not. Were the ones which found a correlation feel at us that it is seen more frequently in patients where diamond dusted scraper were used, while in the Pioneer study which is conducted, there was no association with the choice of instrument. Rather, the intraoperative retinal thickness during the intraoperative OCT was increased. So they came up with the hypothesis that maybe it is due to an intraop trauma or traction. So till now, what do we know about this dissociated optic nerve fiber layer? It is seen in around 30 to 60% of the cases after internal membrane peeling. It is a late post-op period finding, appears after 1 to 3 months, more distinct after 6 months. There is no effect on vision or microperimetry as compared to the cases which do not develop this feature. And it is probably due to Müller cell end plate loss. On blue filter, it is best seen on blue filter. It looks like a dark striae in RNFL arrangement. On OCT, we see inner retinal dimpling. On ENFAS imaging, we see an moth-eaten appearance. This was named as concentric macular dark spot appearance, this feature on ENFAS, because they came up with a theory that it is best seen on ENFAS imaging rather than only the plain OCT scan. A similar feature was seen in ILM peeled eyes, which was called as swelling of the arcuate nerve fiber layer, or the short form used as SANFIL. This was seen in the immediate postoperative period. On blue autofluorescence, dark hyperreflective striae originating from the optic nerve head were seen radiating an arcuate pattern towards the macula. This was seen in initial post-op days, but after 6 months, this feature disappeared. In OCT scans, there was a hyperreflective area or swelling in the nerve fiber layer. So how to differentiate between the two? This was because of subacute trauma to Müller cell enclave due to the ILM peeling disruption, ILM peeling causing disruption of exoplasmic flow. It disappeared in 2 to 3 months in all the eyes, and there was no significant effect on the visual acuity also. Recently, this year, they came up with a hypothesis that it might be because of apoptosis of the anchorage dependent cells, or what we call as anaichis. Now, anaichis is apoptosis of the anchorage dependent cells when they are detached from the proximal cells of the basement membrane. There are certain molecules which are expressed in retinal ganglion cells like beta A1, A3 crystallines and E-cadherins. So the question now was arranged whether it is because of the apoptosis of the retinal ganglion cells or the Müller cells. There is still ongoing research in this topic, whether use of neurotrophic factors causing inhibition of apoptosis can be used for prophylaxis in such cases. Finally, whether this condition is because of direct surgical trauma or it is just a feature which we are seeing in these eyes, which does not affect visual function. The things which point towards the fact that it might not be because of direct surgical trauma is that it is not an immediate post-op finding, and it might be because of apoptosis of the retinal tissue after the ILM peeling. So whether we need to do a long-term follow-up in these patients or not is again a question. And we need more research in these patients to see how this is affecting the visual acuity. Thank you.
Kasim, you raised a hand. You have to ask a question.
Accidental, sir.
Accidental questioning. All right.
That was nice case and very nice images of the anphas. Is there any clue on the preoperative OCT that this is likely to happen, or intraoperatively whether the ILM could be peeled in toto or piecemeal, or whether you use the finesse loop or the forceps to pinch it and start? Because sometimes you do see those little depressions on the surface at the spots where you start. So, yeah, just that these case, little doubts I had.
Yeah, both cases are mine. I mean, both eyes done. So I usually don't use a finesse loop. I'm more a pinch peel person, and I usually use the temporal aspect to start my peel above the horizontal meridian. So there's nothing different in what I've been doing. But this, I just saw this. Incidentally, after many months, when he continued to come, I had, because his left eye was not improving. So we used to
do an ILM inverted flap in the left eye?
No, ma'am, I don't do any inverted flap. It was a
because
tiny hole.
The picture looked like that.
No, ma'am, I didn't do any flap. Routine, I just did the routine ILM peeling.
Okay, one more query is, sometimes we find ILM comes out like a nice neat sheet. Sometimes the ILM comes out in bits and you have a little ERM, that proliferation on the surface that has to be removed, which stains poorly and the margins of the hole. Are any of those related to this appearance? Or sometimes you find entire ILM comes like a nice sheet, but it doesn't always happen. So is there anything to indicate?
No, I'm not sure, ma'am. I think, ma'am, this seems to be just an interesting imaging phenomenon that we see post ILM peel surgeries. But I'm not sure people have really gone really deep into why it is. I mean, of course, there are real research, in vivo research for this.
Obviously, probably because the outer layers are okay, so probably doesn't affect the vision much.
Yeah.
Very nice case and very well, photos are very well documented. So this dissociated optic nerve fiber is quite commonly seen after ILM peeling. Many cases will have that if you look very closely. What I wanted to know is whether Priyanka came across any study where they have compared this kind of area of ILM peel, or, you know, in case there are cases where the ILM peeling has been done in a very small area, then you can actually compare the peeled area versus the non-peeled area. Whether any such,
No, ma'am, I did not come across any of such, where the area of the ILM peeling is compared.
Okay, because some people do even fovea sparing ILM peeling. Some people will do only a small one diameter of ILM peeling around the hole. Some people will do very large, 4-5 disc diameters of ILM peeling. So we'll have
Actually, we should do it prospectively, ma'am.
What you can do is, you do a study, do the analysis in the macular area and do on the nasal area, where obviously the nasal area ILM is not peeled, and see whether you can see such a thing nasally or no.
Prospectively, in all cases of ILM peeling, we must do an on-fast OCT after a glass appointment and another 3 months, 4 months later to see whether it's actually, and of course we document the ILM peeled area. Ma'am, you had to say something, Dr. Muna?
Yeah, what I suggest is have a little questionnaire before the surgery itself, so that by force of habit, we all fill in certain basic information, and like the technique, was there any epiretinal proliferation at the borders? What was the extent of ILM peel? Were there retinal hemorrhages during the peeling? How was it initiated? I think maybe, Priyanka, you can make a list of things that we need to mention.
Yes, ma'am.
And all of you, by routine, Anyway, you all save so many versions of your OT notes. So you can save this one also. So then everyone can fill in what was appropriate. And then, like we all know, that when you do a very small macular hole at glass appointment, very often we find there's still a small amount of subretinal fluid, whatever you do, and that closes later. Whereas in a large macular hole, that doesn't happen. So, you know, little things like this, which will predict our surgical success, will serve as a biomarker. I think as prospectively, if we write, it's better. Did the ILM come as a sheet? Did it come piecemeal? What was it? Just make a little list and make sure all of you fill it in.
And I suggest that everybody should do a macular cube so that we get an idea of the whole area which is involved, instead of getting just radial scans. Pradeep had...
whole protocol has macular cube only. They may be just showing. So I think that protocol is in place. Yeah.
Pradeep had asked, raise his hand.
No, I'm almost second the same thoughts what madam had was just spoke. Same thing I was thinking, like this is an investigation which when we go more deeper and deeper to see the normal changes, we have to put across to the surgical steps each minute details, like at the end of the surgery immediately before losing the fresh memory, where exactly the peel didn't come, where exactly we had the little tug when we peeled it so easily. And when we memorize that, was it in the nasal or whatever the clock covers, and immediately go back in the post-op OCT to compare, maybe we can get some clue.
Yeah, as madam said, no, we just write down the steps.
Exactly.
Where did you start? How much ILM peeled? What instrument used? What stain used? And of course, how it was closed?
It probably looks like more of just a small... trivial changes which happen during surgery. Like for example, a cataract surgeon, if he has peeled the cortex from the periphery, which cortex has got stuck to the capsule more and which came off easily, it all depends on so these are like more of a trivial changes which we documented on OCT, which we can extrapolate back to the surgery and then find a coincidence. That's a good, but very good observation. Very, very good observation. In fact, with I had an ERM, I just showed Sneha today, like how badly suddenly it just there so much that it doesn't come, and suddenly it comes in a full go. It may pick up some of the Müller cells and then cause these changes. Thanks.
Dr. D.A.D. ma'am?
Yeah. So there is one more observation. Probably apart from the ILM peeling process, there may be other factors also which are involved, because especially this scan, it showed some thinning of the area where the dimpling was seen, that retinal thinning was seen, especially on that nasal side in one eye. And so probably it will matter, the ILM peeling plus other things like such as the FG pressure, or how long the FG has been done, probably even the prone position, all that probably might be, involved. And one more interesting thing is that it might be because of the Müller cell damage. I'm not very sure whether the ganglion cell apoptosis occurs. But if you remember, I did one study of multifocal ERG in macular holes. And in that study, we found that the MF-ERG did not improve immediately after the macular hole closure. So, although the macular hole closed and your visual acuity improved, the MFERG did not improve, and it actually took, it took some time for the MFERG to improve. And then when I was doing the research, the review of literature for that, I found that it takes about 1 year for the MFERG also to improve. So, possibly some amount of ganglion cell damage might be involved in this.
Good point, man. We'll just hope in future we ever have a microperimetry. You can probably do a finer study of these factors.